Hello, and welcome to The Works. I'm Ben Peltier.
And I'm Ben Che. Today, and in the coming 2 weeks, we'll feature three very different local singer-songwriters on the show to find out what inspires them to write their own music. Later in this week's show, I'll be talking to Hong Kong-raised Cehryl, who recently returned here after spending time in the United States and the United Kingdom, about readjusting her life and telling her personal stories through songs.
There are six main kinds of impairments that can affect people: auditory, visual, speech, cognitive, neurological, and physical. However, society often doesn't do enough in terms of accessibility and designing for people with such impairments. To empower students and to address such needs, in July, the Hong Kong Design Institute's Advanced Design Studio held an exhibition showcasing design solutions for the visually impaired.
Demonstrating the inseparable relationship between design and daily life, the HKDI Advanced Design Studio, ADS, encourages students to design products for the underprivileged and needy in the community. This year, the studio presented Designed for Well-Being, Lights from the Dark, a collaborative project with the Hong Kong Society for the Blind, in which a group of HKDI students created products to facilitate the daily life of the visually impaired and to promote the concept of social inclusion.
自己嘅視力嘅話，就會係就偏向摸到個，
Graduate John Ho originally planned to design sports products for the visually impaired. After meeting Kitty, a visually impaired mother, he changed his plan and decided to focus on baby products. He came up with a baby stroller project, Embrace.
當初有機會同盲中心去interview 啦，當去到知道Kitty係一個媽咪，會唔會媽咪同視像人士，會唔會過程中可能使用啲產品會有好多問題呢？我哋嘅Tutor就mention話BB車，就有得諗，就向住呢個方向去做，所以就到依家就有呢個我嘅設計 Embrace 咯，就 BB 車咁樣。 這個運作就是它有個brake的，就是按實個 brake 嗰陣咧就可以退，咁放手嗰陣就會剎停，即係好似用咗機場嗰啲手推車嘅原理咁樣去做咯，即係都驚，就可能啲視像父母可能睇得好朦嘅時候，可能推緊時候先有嘢閃過，即係好自然反應咁可能鬆個手，咁鬆個手如果 BB 車繼續向前行嘅，佢睇唔到個BB車嘅位置喺邊咯，咁所以做呢個嘅設計就諗住啊，讓 BB 車。 放手嗰刻停喺度，都唔會話走得好遠，都可以揾得翻咯。而家市面上嗰啲
BB 車好多時都個距離同個父母嘅距離都會有翻咁上下嘅，咁就變相我又睇唔清啦，咁又用手觸摸唔到究竟 BB 做緊乜嘢，確保唔到佢嘅安全。因為我自己本身就未有想象過視像可以用 BB 車啦，咁嗰時阿張好細心咁樣問咗我好多關於即係話用 BB 車，即係平時會遇到咩困難，咁我就記得有一點就係講到就係話我想高啲，因為我始終就係要靠觸摸去摸到個 BB 嘅即係做緊乜嘢，咁而家呢個 model 就係會貼身高身啲咁樣，個面就會變相行出面坐就可以望到多啲風景咁咯。
我諗前前後後都可能多過20次、30次都唔定，因為真係有啲好細節嘅，即係可能佢嗰個高度咧，本身都要不斷可能逐寸逐寸咁減，即係可能本身好長嘅，咁試下感覺，咦，好似高得滯喎，再減，再試，咦，個感覺咦好啲喎，可能再減，即係不斷去 tune 咯。
我諗好多視像都會覺得好感恩，就係有真係一班人真係會為你度身訂做一樣嘢啦。有啲咩困難嘅地方可以從而改善，咁令到係咯，即係更加方便我哋視像啦，係啦。
Working out the positions of dining utensils and food can be another big challenge for visually impaired individuals. Recognizing the difficulties that they may face in enjoying their daily meals, Mac Liu began his project, Relish. He's designed a tableware set made of unique materials with sharp color contrast that he hopes will provide a more pleasant dining experience.
我自己都有視障人士受到視力的影響啦，即係可能都未必話睇到個餐具嘅位置，同埋有陣時佢哋筆送嗰陣時咧，都會筆寫啲餸，即係令到成件事好輪進。呢個餐具嘅特點咧，就個碟咧其實有一個弧度嘅，就希望佢哋筆送嗰陣時咧可以兜翻轉啲食物咯。 咁就防止佢哋即係不捨啲食物，咁仲有個餐墊啦，其實有啲凹凸嘅紋理嘅，即係希望佢哋可以透過觸感去區分嗰個區域，然之後擺翻相應嘅餐具。成set個餐具啦，其實有一個好明顯嘅顏色嘅對比，咁就希望佢哋可以透過呢個對咁鮮明嘅對比顏色啦，就見到嗰個餐具嘅位置咯。
我就覺得非常好嘅呢個設計，因為平時咧見到啲視障朋友咧，如果佢哋想知道係叉同埋羹咧，佢要摸上邊啊。咁而家啦，尤其是疫情啦，要衞生程度，咁你摸完呢度好似啱啱又幫佢抹乾淨咁就好似好污糟啦。咁但係如果而家咧有呢個點咧，佢自己都可以一分就分到哦，一點嘅係羹，兩點嘅咧係有呢一個嘅鋸齒嘅咁。 其實我覺得今次合作係好開心同埋好感動嘅，因為我哋而家成日都講要製造一個無障礙嘅城市啦。咁但係其實可能喺一啲新嘅設計啦，或者新嘅發明咧，都係着重美觀為主。咁啊，美觀咧就通常就未必咁實用噶啦。 嚟到我哋香港萬人輔導會啦，我哋透過嘅參觀同埋再同我哋嘅同事啦，同埋我哋嘅服務使用者傾偈，我相信佢哋係不斷改良緊咯，即係呢個開頭我已經唔係初稿嚟嘅，即係一路改良，到我真係睇佢哋嘅畢業展嘅時候，我自己係覺得好感動咯，同埋覺得好驚訝，哇咁勁嘅咁樣。
設計師界係天馬行空嘅，有好多好多好好嘅 idea 嘅，我都好鼓勵同學咧，盡量發揮佢嘅創意。咁但係去到一個 point 咧，佢哋需要咧就揾翻個 user 嚟傾一傾啦，究竟嗰啲佢哋睇到嘅點係咪真係即係嗰個 user 需要嘅咧？設計以人為本啦，同理心係一個主軸嚟嘅，其實即係同學如果經過呢個 project。 知道即係做設計嘅時候咧，需要真係有 empathy， 有同理心。咁我相信佢做任何嘅設計咧，一定會好成功。Artist
Tino Seghal creates what he describes as constructed situations that challenge the definition of art and the idea of art as a commodity. Designed to leave no footprint, his work emphasizes people, not things. He focuses on interactions, exchanges, and conversations by recruiting local interpreters of all ages to engage with the audience.
You can experience two of Seghal's best-known pieces at Taekwon until the end of this week in the Trust and Confusion exhibition. 150 Hong Kong interpreters between 16 and 73 have been recruited for these associations in the prison yard, 30 of whom will take part in each performance. The other work, this variation, takes place in a dark room where professional dancers improvise and interact with people who come in.
As Seghal wants no physical trail of his works, neither photographing or filming them is allowed. But he did speak to us via the internet.
If you think of the word situation, then you think that we are all in a situation together, right? Like when you think of the word performing or performance, you think somebody's performing, one group is active, the other group is passive. In a situation, everybody is active, everybody's passive. And so in my work, there's also no stage. You need to perform on a stage. So it's like on one level, the visitors and the participants enacting the piece, they're on the same level. I grew up in the 80s, 90s, so the 20th century, no? There was a kind of infatuation, like cultural infatuation with technology, with object. Technology is good, but the most complex technology on this planet is still human beings, you know? So I'm an ambitious person when it comes to making art, so I want to work with the most complex technology there is, so to speak, you know? And to stay in this metaphor, and so that most complex entity, you know, are human beings. So I work with human beings instead of with some kind of sophisticated machine. There was only so much pleasure I could derive from consuming an object, you know? And I felt that like more traditional activities, more traditional artistic media, like singing, like dancing, like speaking, they were not so valued, let's say also not valued in our kind of places which have the highest legitimation, which at least here in the West is museums. Because these interactions between the visitor and the participants, they are anonymous. You don't know who is this person who's talking to you. You know, you don't know their name even. And because of this anonymity, there can be more vulnerability, more humanness. And sometimes you hear something very intimate, but it's also only for you. So I try to also say, like, this is my area. If you want to encounter my work, you have to come to that. Obviously, much less people will see my work. That's a high price I pay. But it's my choice, you know.
Hong Kong-born and raised singer-songwriter Cehryl attended the Berklee College of Music and later moved to Los Angeles. Plans to tour with her music were put on hold due to the COVID-19 pandemic, and so she's back in Hong Kong, at least for a while. Her musical interests range from R&B and punk to indie pop folk. She's also passionate about photography and films. She's here to tell us more about her new EP, Time Machine.
Cehryl, welcome to The Works.
Thank you.
Let's start by talking about your musical background and journey. So I know you're a singer-songwriter, you're a producer, but you also mix and all that. How did all that happen, and what was the journey that kind of brought you to where you are today?
Initially, I wanted to be a composer because I was a pianist, but I was very lazy. And then later on, I picked up guitar because I liked writing lyrics a lot. So that turned to songwriting. And then with producing, I just happened to start getting a bit more into it because I'm an introvert and I prefer, like, I like figuring things out by myself, which was nice. And because technology and all that music technology is so democratized now. Mm-hmm. Anyone can learn anything. You don't have to have prior skills or like a certificate or whatever.
And as a songwriter, what things sort of inspire you, or what sort of what's your songwriting process like?
My songwriting process is very personal. I'd say everything comes from real experience and probably just comes from stupid little notes in my iPhone. I mean, it's songwriting is poetry just to music, and I love reading and literature, so I think that books really inspire me, movies as well.
And you mentioned earlier everything is sort of democratized, it's easier to access things now. Do you feel that in your generation more artists are doing everything from songwriting to producing to, you know, all those music videos and so on?
Yeah, for sure, because the technology is available and it's more accessible in terms, like, financially. And I think there's, because of the internet, like the community of music making, everything's just so transparent. You don't have to rely on a label or reach out to some producer you don't really trust. You can just kind of go on forums and figure it out yourself. So I think that's a really big advantage that I have. And I think it's a really good thing for music worldwide.
Now, you recently released an EP early this year. Mm-hmm. Tell us the different things you've released over the years. How has your music either changed, or how has your songwriting changed as well?
I think my songwriting, when I first started songwriting, I really wanted to write pop music because that's what I listened to. And for me, it was just fun. But as I grow older, I want to do things that are a little bit more experimental, whether it's in the production side or whether it's the writing. I think I've paid more attention to my writing and, you know, referencing poets that I liked or just, I don't know, writers that I liked. These days I've been listening to a lot of like folk past few years, so I definitely can hear that in my music as well. Everything's just a very natural like amalgamation of what I've been listening to in the period that I'm making my music,
Okay, and I also know that recently you've had a live concert where you actually have a live band. Previously, you were telling me that you tend to work on your own more.
Yeah.
What was that process like, and what was the experience like for you working with a live band?
It was really easy because they were friends. So they were friends that I would normally jam with anyway. So it felt very natural again. And I think that's the thing with collaborating on music, I find it very hard to accept when we're friends.
Okay.
Yeah.
And speaking of collaboration, you've also been doing soundtracks and other things for movies and stuff.
Yeah.
So tell us about that. How does it feel to be composing for soundtracks, and must be very different from songwriting for like a guitar? So.
It's very different. It's actually what I wanted to do when I was younger, because I was shy and I never really wanted to sing. Mm. But it came really naturally because a lot of my friends are film people, and if I didn't do music, I think I would be doing film. Mm. So it feels like I like visual things, and visual things inspire me. So in a way, scoring short films and whatnot, it's like an exercise. Mm. It's like a challenge to match a certain mood with music. So yeah.
And as someone who was classically trained when you were younger on piano, yeah. Do you find that that has actually affected how you compose or write now, or is that something just totally separate?
I think it's informed a lot of my musical knowledge. Mm. Not necessarily just when I'm soundtracking, even when I'm songwriting like more poppy stuff. I think it informs my knowledge of harmony, or my ear for harmony. Mm. Not super advanced, but I think it's there somewhere in the back of my mind.
And finally, just for today, I know you're going to play a song for us in the studio. Can you tell us the name of the song and what the song is about?
The song's name is Disconnected. It's kind of an older song from my first album, which was released in 2019, so kind of old. But I like playing it on my nylon guitars, which is why I did it today, which is why I'm doing it today. And the song is about... the lyrics are pretty self-explanatory, but it is about... losing a connection. And I guess it's about loss and the shame of it. Yeah.
Okay. Looking forward to hearing
it. Thank you.
You're all from all of me. sick of cleaning up the aftertaste, and I'm always listening to whispering. I hope I see you at the corner store when I'm back to travel.